Congrats. I am unable to speak in your mother tongue, so I will be speaking English, and comrade shall be translating it into your mother tongue that is coming. Now the subject that is placed before you, upon which I have to speak, is the left approach to neo-Marxism. And because we are in India, we are in a fascistic situation. First of all, I shall explain about what is meant by neo-fascism and fascism. We know fascism, as far as world people are concerned, first originated in Europe during the interwar period in the form of fascism in Italy led by Mussolini, and Nazism, that is also fascism, led by Hitler in Germany. So the historical context for the emergence of fascism was the unprecedented severe political, economic crisis, social tensions, which compelled the ruling classes. Ruling classes means, we know that we are in a world of capitalism, capitalist imperialism. So ruling classes means imperialist ruling classes. So when imperialist ruling classes, or when finance capital or corporate capitalists, when they face very serious crisis which they cannot manage through normal methods, because capital can survive only through constant extraction or constant exploitation, constantly extracting what is called, from a Marxist perspective, we can call surplus value from the people. Constantly extracting, exploiting people, capital can continue, or capitalists can continue. Constantly exploit markets, constantly exploit, plunder resources. Only through plunder and exploitation that capitalism can survive. So if this plunder and exploitation, if it cannot be continued in the normal process, then naturally capitalist forces, imperialist forces will resort to other means. For example, parliamentary methods, where democratic rights are there, where workers have the right to bargain, where the oppressed people, the women, the toiling masses, and other marginalized people, when they have the right to bargain, when they have the right to struggle, in a crisis-ridden situation, when crisis is intensified, imperialism cannot allow that. It is in such a situation that other means of rule, that is fascistic, terrorist dictatorship, where no democratic rights are there. So it is in such a situation that fascism originates. That is the understanding, that is the idea that was conveyed when fascism emerged in Europe during the interwar period.
அனைவருக்கும் வணக்கம். நான் வந்து என்னுடைய உங்களுக்கு புரிந்த மொழியில் நான் வந்து பேச முடியாது கண்டு தெரிவிச்சுக்கிறேன். நான் இப்போ நேரடியாக தோழர் விஷயத்துக்கு போகிறேன். நாம் வந்து இப்போ இந்தியாவில் இருக்கிறோம். இந்தியா வந்து இப்போ மிகப்பெரிய ஒரு பாசிச அரசாக நம்மளுடைய இந்திய அரசு வந்து இருந்துகிட்டு இருக்குது. அதுக்கு முன்னாடி முதல்ல வந்து நான் பாசிசம்னா என்ன அப்படின்றத வந்து விளக்குவதற்கு விரும்ப போகிறேன். அதாவது பாசிசம் வந்து முதல்ல வந்து யூரோப்பில் உருவாகுது. அதுக்கப்புறம் முசோலினியால் பாசிசம் வந்து கொண்டு வரப்படுது. அதுக்கப்புறம் வந்து ஜெர்மனியில வந்து ஹிட்லர் ஆற வந்தது. எப்போ வந்து பாசிசம் வருது அப்படின்னு சொல்லி பார்த்தீங்கன்னா, இந்த முதலாளித்துவ உலகம் வந்து மிகப்பெரிய ஒரு சிக்கலை, பொருளாதார சிக்கலை, சமூக ரீதியான சிக்கலை சந்திக்கும் பொழுது அதுக்கு புதிய வடிவத்துல ஒரு விஷயம் வந்து மக்களை சுரண்டுவதற்கு தேவைப்படுது. ஏன்னா நம்மளுடைய மூலதனம் என்பது வந்து உழைப்பாளிகளுடைய உழைப்பை சுரண்டி, இங்க இருக்கக்கூடிய மக்களுடைய உழைப்பை சுரண்டி சுரண்டிதான் மூலதனம் வந்து வாழ முடியும். மூலதனம் வந்து தனியா தான் வராது, மக்களுடைய அந்த சர்ப்ளஸ் வேல்யூ அப்படின்னு சொல்லிக்கலாம், உபரி மதிப்பு, முதலாளிகளுடைய உபரி மதிப்பு, மக்களுடைய விஷயங்களை சுரண்டுவதன் மூலமாக தான் மூலதனம் வளர முடியும். இப்போ மிகப்பெரிய பொருளாதார நெருக்கடியை சிக்கலை சந்திக்கும் பொழுது அந்த மூலதனம் தன்னை வளர்த்துக் கொள்வதற்காக புதிய வழிமுறைகளை வந்து உருவாக்குது. அப்படி புதிய வழிமுறைகளை உருவாக்குறது வந்து தான் வந்து என்னன்னு பார்த்தீங்கன்னா பாசிசம். இப்போ உதாரணத்துக்கு நம்ம எடுத்துக்கிட்டோம்னா நாடாளுமன்றம் அப்படின்ற ஒரு வடிவம், அது அதன் மூலமா அரசு வந்து இங்கே ஆட்சி செய்யுது. நாடாளுமன்ற வடிவத்துல பொதுவாக நம்ம என்ன பண்ணலாம்னா, பெண்கள், பாதிக்கப்பட்டவர்கள், ஒடுக்கப்பட்ட மக்கள், அவங்களுக்கெல்லாம் தங்களுக்கான சில உரிமைகளை போராடி பெற்றுக்கிறதுக்காக அவருடைய பிரதிநிதிகள் நாடாளுமன்றத்தில் இருக்காங்க. ஆனா மிகப்பெரிய ஒரு பொருளாதார சிக்கல், சமூக சிக்கல் வந்ததுன்னா உடனடியாக நாடாளுமன்றம் என்பது நம்மளுடைய சிக்கலை பேசுவதற்கோ இல்லை வெளியிலிருந்து நம்ம போராடி அதன் மூலமா மருத்துவ கொடுப்பதற்கும் மாற்றத்துக்கு ஏற்பட்ட ஒரு வடிவம் தான் நாடாளுமன்றம். ஆனா சமூகம் வந்து, அதாவது மூலதனம் தன்னுடைய பொருளாதார சிக்கலை சந்திக்கும் பொழுது அது என்ன பண்ணுதுன்னா இந்த வழிமுறைகள் எல்லாம் அடைச்சிருக்கு. அதாவது இனிமே வந்து எதுவுமே நீ பேச முடியாது, எதற்காகவும் நீ போராட முடியாது, நாங்க என்ன சொல்றோமோ அதை மட்டும் தான் நீ செய்யணும் அப்படின்னு ஒரு சட்டத்திட்டத்தை கொண்டு வருது. அப்படி கொண்டு வரதுக்கு பேர் தான் என்ன சொல்றாங்கன்னா பாசிசம் அப்படின்னு ஒரு வடிவத்தை எடுக்கிறதா சொல்றாரு. அதாவது வழக்கமான முறையில சுரண்டலை, நம்ம பொதுவா இதை புரிஞ்சுக்கோனா வழக்கமான முறையில சுரண்டலை தொடர செய்ய முடியாத பொழுது, சுரண்டலை நம்ம வந்து தொடர முடியாத பொழுது புதிய வடிவமான பாசிசத்தை இந்த அரசுகள் மேற்கொள்கின்றன.
So coming to you, I am making things a bit more simple. For example, in Germany and Italy, we know Germany and Italy were capitalist powers, big powers of Europe. But these powers, during the First World War, the Germany and Italy lost their colonies. Because in the First World War, Germany and Italy were the losers. So externally, they had little chance of, Germany and Italy had little chance of exploitation. That means plundering the colonies, like Britain or France, or like USA, which without colonies, which could plunder Latin American countries. Internally, that means domestically within the country, working class movements were advancing, social tensions were increasing. In the neighboring Soviet Union, communist advancement was there, Soviet Union socialism was advancing. So threat was there from external sources. Internally, workers were struggling, democratic forces were struggling, minorities, oppressed people were coming forward. So it was in that situation that the Italy and Germany resorted to fascism. People will say, several stories will there. It is because of Mussolini, it is because of Modi, it is because of Hitler that fascism comes. Of course, individuals play a role, but individuals are only having secondary role. The primary role, as far as we left forces, democratic forces, we communists are concerned, we must understand that the cause for fascism is not individuals. Fascism originates, emerges because of the crisis, the ever intensifying crisis in society. So when crisis intensifies, when capitalists find it difficult to manage this crisis, to carry forward their plunder, they resort to other means. That is why normal methods of plunder, because capitalism is normally plundering, even in parliamentary democracy also they are plundering. But even in that situation, this kind of normal methods cannot be carried forward. Therefore, what they will do? They will abolish, they will take away the democratic rights, parliamentary forms, and they will impose dictatorship of finance capital. So that is what has happened in Italy and Germany during the interwar period. Interwar period means during the 20s and the 30s. So Communist International. Communist International means Comintern. At that time, the Communist parties, because at that time, you know, world was having Communist advancement was there. India, national liberation movements were advancing. All over the world, people were advancing against colonialism and imperialism. In India, we know struggles against a British colonialism, led by Gandhi, led by the communists, led by many patriots, many sacrifices were there. So all over the world, communist advancement was there. National liberation movements were advancing. So at that time, it was at that particular contest, what happened in Italy and Germany, in two countries, the ruling classes find it difficult to manage, therefore they chose their leaders as Mussolini and Hitler. And led by Mussolini and Hitler, I am not going into those details, because of all school children we in our schools and colleges, we have studied about that. So Hitler and Mussolini came to power, and what happened in Italy, in Germany, Holocaust upon Holocaust, genocides and mass murders, and many atrocities, many exterminations against Jews, against communists, and against trade union leaders, all were there. This is what happened in Europe, which we call classical fascism. This is called classical fascism. Okay, I am just explaining. So in the what happened? The Communist International, only the communists at that time, the communist movement, they studied. The leader of the Communist International at that time was Dimitrov, general secretary. So Dimitrov made a detailed study of this fascism, and he defined it. He said that fascism is, many explanations were there. It is Mussolini's that is enmity. It is the character of Hitler, etc. But Dimitrov defined fascism. It is the terrorist dictatorship of the most reactionary elements of finance capital. Finance capital means corporates, big corporates. So the most reactionary sections of finance capital is most reactionary sections of the big capitalists. Not all capitalists, the most reactionary elements, they will be imposing a terrorist dictatorship on the people. That is fascism. And even today, this is the generally accepted understanding of fascism when we speak about the neo-fascism or whatever we call, this is the understanding. Now, comrades, so I am not going into those details because that is part of history. Today, what we are seeing, today we are in the neoliberal period. What is neoliberalism? Neoliberalism means, so I have to explain neo-fascism. That is what I have started. Classical fascism was in the pre-war period, that is before Second World War. But today we are in the neoliberal period. What is neoliberalism? Neoliberalism means, after Second World War, capitalism at a global level unleashed, or they initiated a welfare state. Welfare state means, you know, public sector, democratic rights of workers, and many other rights were there. Employment was increasing, income was increasing, very high taxes on corporates, government intervention in the economy, private sector was controlled, capitalists, many restrictions were there on capitalists. So such a system was there after the Second World War. We know about the Nehruvian policies in India, Nehruvian model. We have heard that Jawaharlal Nehru, led by Nehru, many good policies, capitalism. The system was capitalist system. Ruling classes were there. feudal forces were there or other forces were there, but still some form of welfare measures were there. So this is called welfare capitalism. Capitalism, but some mass, some what is called a human face, a human face was there. But after the 70s, what has happened? This human face was taken away because capitalism confronted a very big crisis. Capitalism faced another crisis in the 70s. We know that oil crisis. So what has happened because of this crisis? What has happened? This welfare state was abandoned. Capitalism abandoned the welfare state. Why? In the 30s, during the 30s, what happened? There, communist advancement was there, left advancement was there, progressive forces were advancing. Therefore, after the Second World War, imperialism, capitalists were compelled to impose welfare state. But after the 70s, internationally, communist forces faced a setback. Soviet Union, we lost. First socialist state went into capitalism. China abandoned socialism. 70s, by the end of 70s, China also embraced the capitalist path. So all over the world, communist forces failed, setbacks. Taking this as an advantage, what has happened? The capitalist forces all over the world, they abandoned welfare state. In India also, all over the world, abandoning the welfare state and a new liberalism means, neoliberalism means capitalism, capital, the therapies like that, these capitalist forces, which we call corporate capitals, Ambani, Adani, like forces, they were given unfettered freedom, uncontrolled freedom to plunder people, natural resources, and whatever they have, everything was given to them. Taxes were reduced. You see, today what is the tax rate? 15%. 15% is the tax rate in India on corporates. During the Nehruvian period, what? 90%. During the Nehruvian period, the highest tax rate in India on corporates was 90%. We must know, we are the citizens of this country. And that money collected by government was spent for welfare activities, free education, democratic rights of workers. So many things were public sector. Subsidies were there. So such a system was there. Now tax rate is reduced to 15%. Petrol, you know all these things, petrol, diesel prices, we know, more than 100 rupees. So such a way is that corporates were allowed to plunder, all this money goes into the pockets of the corporates. Environment, plunder of the environment, no control. So labor laws were liberalized, tax laws were liberalized, environmental laws were liberalized. All democratic rights are being taken away. Workers have no rights. Workers are made slaves. So this is called neoliberalism. So these neoliberal policies came in after the end of the welfare state. Okay. Fascism. Your understanding, your analysis, your evaluation of fascism is not scientific. If not proper, then our struggles against fascism will not be effective. That is why we are explaining this. We must ask left forces, because only the left forces, only the revolutionary forces, only the working class, only the oppressed people, their leadership, only the women, the leadership of women, only the leadership of the oppressed, only the working class and the oppressed people of the world, their leadership, only they can lead the anti-fascist struggle. Nobody can lead the anti-fascist struggle because only they have a correct approach to corporate capital. Only they have a correct approach to capitalism, imperialism, finance capital, corporate capital. So that is why we are discussing this. If we are not discussing, we are not making an academic discussion. We are discussing because we have a political purpose. So to understand that, we must see that today, in the 40s, in the 30s and 40s, today fascism will not be the same thing. Because when several years are over, when time is going, everything is changing. Fascism will also change. The fascism that was in the 40s and the interwar period, that will not repeat in the same form today. Some people will ask, look at Modi. Still we have a parliament. See, Hitler had no parliament. Hitler abolished the parliament. Still Modi, RSS led BJP government is still using parliament. Then how can you say there is fascism? Some people will ask. There are parties. So during Hitler, no other party was there. Only the fascist party, Nazi party was allowed in the world. All others were banned. Today, Narendra Modi government, Congress is there, DMK is there, many parties are there. Then why, what is the problem? How can you say it is fascism? So we must say that every social phenomenon, every social phenomenon will be developing. Today, unlike Hitler, unlike Mussolini, today parliamentary democracy has a 100 years history. During the pre-war period, at that time parliament was in a primitive, that was not that much developed. Today parliamentary democracy has much advanced. So all over the world, this parliamentary system is there. So now fascists have invented a method. They have discovered a method. Keeping parliament, keeping the facade of democracy, keeping the atmosphere of democracy, keeping or camouflaging, that means they can say apparently there is parliament, apparently there is democracy, but in effect there is no democracy. Because if you are criticizing the government, if you are attacking the BJP government, if you are writing, then you will be put as anti-national. UAPA will be in most of you. Many writers, many scholars, many well-meaning people, many women, many youth, many working class leaders, they are in jail. They have not committed any mistake. They have only criticized the Modi. So if you are criticizing the Modi government, then you will be called anti-national. UAPA will be imposed. You will be called a terrorist. Sedition Act will be imposed on you. So this is what is doing now. Now Modi can have parliament. Keeping parliament, Modi is capable to impose fascism. How? Take the case of farmers. Take the case of farmers. What the farmers are doing for 1 year. Comrades and friends, sisters and brothers, during the last 1 year, Indian farmers are struggling, historic struggle, world historic struggle. Nowhere in human history, the farmers have struggled for 1 year. Indian farmers are struggling for 1 year. Why? The three farm laws, draconian farm laws, by which the farmers' right, their land, their produce, prices, everything will be taken away. The draconian, three draconian laws imposed by Modi, these laws will not allow agriculture in this country. All will go under the control of Adani and Ambani. Land will go, multinational companies will come, World Trade Organization, the rule of World Trade Organization is now implemented. American MNCs, Monsanto, Cargill, like our MNCs, DuPont, MNCs will come into country. Their junior partners, Modi and Adani, will rule the country. Food subsidy, public distribution, food security, everything will be over if these farm laws are implemented. how farm laws came into being. Modi put it into parliament. Simply putting it into parliament. No parliamentary discussion. Standing committees of parliament. Consultative committees of parliament. No discussion. So even while keeping parliament, RSS know that parliament, keeping parliament, they can pass fascist laws. Then why parliament needs to be abolished? Parliament can be maintained. By keeping parliament, they can implement fascism. Similarly, labor laws, 44 labor laws were there. 44. All these laws were taken away, abandoned, abolished. Only 4 courts are there. 8-hour work. 8-hour work is the right of the worker. When we go for office work, when we go for manual work, we are human beings. We need to work only for 8 hours. That was the right in the 19th century. We got this right in the 19th century. Not today. Yeah, this is 21st century. We, our forefathers, our ancestors, our fighters in the 19th century, they fought this right. They gained this right. That is 8 hours work per day. Today what Modi has done? 8 hours work, that right is taken away. Now workers can be put for 14 hours. Nobody is there to question. Laws are taken away. In similar manner, in all our fields, all laws are imposed. There is no environmental law. Corporates can plunder the environment. They can plunder forest. They can plunder ocean. They can plunder our land. They can plunder anything. No law is there to control corporates. So corporate capital is given uncontrolled to the people have no right. Only Adani, Ambani and corporate forces have right. Modi's chosen friends, closest friends, they are given freedom. They can do anything. They can, India, I am not going into those details. So what has happened is that this type of an unleashing, uncontrolled finance capital, corporate capital is working with the parliament, no problem. So then some people will ask, parliament is there, then how can you say that fascism is there? That is why today neo-fascism is not a repetition of, is not a textbook copy of, is not a textbook copy of what has happened during the interwar period. Today it is, in form, it will be different, but in content, it will be the same. That is why we call today, under neoliberalism, we call it neo-fascism. Now, neo-fascism is not in India alone. All over the many countries of the world, there are neo-fascism. Europe, in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia, in many countries, neo-fascism, neo-fascist forces are there. Many names are there. So I am not going into those details. So this is the situation that we are now discussing on neo-fascism. Now, I am coming to the central question. So when we, these type of policies, neoliberalism, globalization, liberalization, privatization, that means corporates are given all rights, people have no right, even the right to live. So this can be implemented only through a fascist regime, only through taking away all democratic rights and the state itself becoming terrorist. The state itself becoming a terrorist regime and the state is sponsoring terrorism. State itself is sponsoring terrorism against the people. That we are witnessing all over India today. So in such a situation, that means in this type of policies are possible only by the state becoming terrorist, that means taking away all democratic rights, and the state assumes the character of a fascist. That is neo-fascism. But this is not so simple. Why? There should be some ideological basis. Hitler had an ideology. Hitler said that the Aryan race, Aryans are the superior race. So he used the Aryans, the majority, the majoritarian Aryans as his electoral or as his Marxist base. Support of the Aryans, the majority. Using this majority, he massacred, he eliminated the Jews and all opponents. In the same manner, in other countries, there is no particular ideology. Any ideology can be used by Marxist regime. In India, they are using Hindutva. They are using saffronization, saffron ideology, Hindutva ideology. The American ideology they are using. Manuvad they are using. In Myanmar, what we are seeing? Buddhism. Buddha is Ahimsa. But a state can use even Buddhism, Evangelism. In Latin America, Bolsonaro, Brazil, Bolsonaro is using Evangelism, Christian Evangelism. Trump was using Christian Evangelism. Political Islam. Some countries are using Islam, political Islam. So any ideology can be used. There is no need of a particular ideology. So the state, depending on the situation, a particular ideology will be used as the basis of the regime. So in India, I am coming to that point. In India, we are in a particular situation where the majoritarian, here the theory is that all majority of the people are Hindus. Muslims are the minority, Christians are the minority, and others are the minority. So the majoritarian ideology is used as the basis of the state. So for that, RSS is working behind. What is the history of RSS? I shall explain something about that. We know that RSS came into being in 1925. That gave up. Savarkar, we know about Savarkar, much discussion is going on in papers. He apologized seven times. Seven times he apologized to the British. Bhagat Singh, you know, a youth. He challenged the British. He said, "You shot me at my chest." Bhagat Singh challenged the British government when he was just a youth. But Savarkar, he begged before British imperialism. He begged, he gave what is called, he apologized seven times before the British. He said, "I will cooperate with the British imperialism. Release me from the jail. I will be at your service." So the British released him. We know all this history. So, another variant of the Savarkar was Hindu Mahasabha leader. Then the RSS came in 1921. Edgar Ward. RSS, the founder of Edgar Ward, he was a teacher. His name was Munche. The name of that teacher was Munche. So they founded the RSS in 1921. After the founding of RSS, they claim that they are the patriots. They are the biggest nationalists of the world, that means they love their country, but they never did anything during the freedom struggle. When many people were martyred, many people went to the jail, Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad, Udham Singh, many people, communists, trade union leaders, many thousands and thousands of people spent there, they devoted, they martyred. They gave their life for the independence of the country. These RSS never waged any struggle. We are openly saying, we must say to the people, RSS never waged a struggle. They were supporting the British colonies. They were supporting. Britishers were using RSS against the people who were fighting independence struggle. Not only that. Munche, why I said the name of Munche, the mentor, the teacher of Edgar Ward, he went to He went to Italy. Vasisam was emerging in Europe at that time. When RSS was founded in India, I started my presentation by saying the interwar period of Vasisam in Europe, Mussolini, Hitler. So this RSS leader, Munje, Edgar was teacher, Munje, Dr. Munje, he went to Italy. He met Mussolini. He studied how this Vasisam is working in Italy. He visited the physical academy of Vasisam. Fascist academy, no, Fascist academy of physical science. That was the name. Fascist academy of physical sciences established by Mussolini, where Mussolini was training fascist goons, fascist stormtroopers against people, how the people can be controlled, how people can be eliminated. Training was given. This man visited there. So he got his understanding. He remained in Italy. He met whom? Mussolini himself. He studied about the fascist working there. He returned. After coming to India, what he did? He established a RSS military school in Nasik. The name of that school is known as Mount Sinai School. They established a Sainik military school in Nasik with the help of the British. When the British were ruling, RSS was creating a military school in India in 1937. British never opposed it. Similarly, you know, Hitler, World Worker is the leader of RSS, you know. He was a worshipper of Hitler. He said, look at Hitler, how he eliminated Jews. Hitler eliminated Jews in the same manner. The RSS in India, they can eliminate Muslims because Muslims are the number one enemy of RSS. It is World Worker's book. It is not we are saying. World Worker, in his book, Our Nationhood Defined, a book written by World Worker. In that book, number one enemy is Muslims. Number two enemy, Christians. Number three, communists. These three enemies should be eliminated. This is written there. And they were supporting the British against the people of India at that time. Who RSS? So they never participated in the freedom struggle. They were colonial bootlickers. Colonial bootlickers, colonial servants, servitude to British colonialism, British imperialism. They have nothing to do with the national patriotism. They have nothing to do with the love of the country. They betrayed the country during the colonial period, during the colonial anti-colonial struggle. This is their history. Now, in 1947, power transferred. Britain transferred power to the Indian ruling classes. I am not going into those details. At that time, what RSS did? They unleashed these rights, communal rights. 1 lakh people were murdered in Kashmir alone because of these communal rights. There is so many things are there. I am not going into those details. But RSS demanded one thing, that is very interesting. They demanded that we should have a constitution. We have already a constitution which is Manusmriti. RSS said that the Manusmriti should be made the Indian constitution. RSS demanded. I am saying this from documents. RSS demanded that Manusmriti should be made the Indian constitution. What is Manusmriti saying? Manusmriti is saying that majority of Indians are subhuman. Subhuman means below animals. Below animals means they can be killed. They can be eliminated. They are having no human rights. They are below human, subhuman. Women are below humans. Women have no right. You go through Manusmriti. Manusmriti says that women deserve no freedom. women should be slaves of men. That is Manusmriti says. Then majority of Indians, the lower class people, the Dalits, the Adivasis, they have no rights. They are subhumans. Only the elite, the Brahmins, the Kshatriyas, they are the rulers. Only they should have the right. So this is Manusmriti. It was this Manusmriti that Dr. Ambedkar banned this Manusmriti in 1927. You must understand. Dr. Ambedkar, who wrote the Indian Constitution, the leader of the oppressed, the leader of the Dalit in India, Dr. Ambedkar, he banned this Manusmriti in 1927. When RSS was formed in 1925, when Munje was going to Italy, the leader of the oppressed in India, Dr. Ambedkar, banned Manusmriti in 1927. This is Indian history. The same Manusmriti, when power was transferred, RSS in their book, their mouthpiece organ, its name is Organizer. In that Organizer, RSS wrote, we need Manusmriti as the Indian Constitution. That is RSS. And we know all history, the martyrdom, the assassination of Gandhi, Patel's statement, the then Home Minister Patel wrote to Jawaharlal Nehru that this RSS is creating problems in the country. If RSS is not banned, the country will go to anarchy. So RSS was banned for some time. This is the Indian history. Now I am not going into those parts. Today, who is ruling the country? Today RSS is ruling the country. Okay, go. For the people. They were RSS people, RSS no credibility before the people because they were because of the Gandhi assassination. RSS claimed that they are not directly involved. But many evidences are there. These people were instigated, RSS distributed sheets when Mahatma Gandhi, father of the nation was murdered, RSS distributed suits among its members. This is written. So they say that they are not involved. Godse was not their favorite person. That is another question because you RSS have hundreds of thousands of organizations, secret and open. RSS is the biggest fascist organization in the world. RSS is the biggest fascist organization in the world, not only in India, all over the world. Many affiliated organizations are there for RSS. In America, RSS has its subsidiaries. Hindu Seva Sangh, that means global level. Hindu-American alliance, so many Hindu Republican alliance, so many alliances are there. So RSS has hundreds of thousands of organizations. Bajarandal, Durga Vahini, Vishwa Hindu Parishad, so many other organizations. So we know all these things. So this RSS is involved in many things. We have heard, I am just giving you an example. We know Hemant Karkare, who was martyred in the Bombay riot, that police officer. Hemant Karkare's wife recently died, we know from the papers. Karkare's wife is also recently died. This Hemant Karkare, he was an upright police officer, a just police officer. While he was enquiring about the Bombay riots, he caught some other persons, Purohit and some other persons. When he enquired, Hemant Karkare found an interesting thing. This Makkah-Malegaon explosion, Makkah-Masjid explosion, Malegaon explosion, where Muslims are, churches are there. Near there, RSS people, these Hindu forces, they committed explosion. No evidence is there. But Hemant Karkare found that. I mentioned about the Bonsale Military School in 1937, Nasik. Munche established a Bonsale Military School. those who came out of the Bonsale military school, they are involved in this Makkah and Makkah Masjid and this Baregawa explosion. Ahmed Garkare found. But we know what happened to Ahmed Garkare. Ahmed Garkare was killed in the Bombay explosion. So that case is over. This is the problem. So many communal rights. Hundreds of thousands of people were murdered in India throughout this period. So RSS has no credibility. But in the emergency, in the 70s, during the 70s when emergency came, when Indira Gandhi declared emergency, RSS came to the front fighting against emergency. RSS fighting against emergency, RSS got credibility. And they created BJP. They abandoned the Janasangh. They created a new party, a political tool called BJP in the fight against emergency. Slowly, within 20 years, two decades, creation of BJP by the late 70s, by the end of 90s, BJP came to power. RSS has claimed that this BJP is only their political tool. Their political tool, BJP, because RSS is a cultural organization. Nowhere in the world a cultural organization is leading a country. RSS is a cultural organization, claiming so. This cultural organization has a political party, BJP. It has the biggest trade union, BMS. It has the biggest student organization, Akhila Bharata Vidyarthi Parishad. It has the biggest educational institution, what is called Vidya Bharati. Vidya Bharati has lots of students and thousands of institutions in India. The biggest educational institution in India is Vidya Bharati. Sorry. Yes, Vidya Bharati. Yes. So such organizations are there. RSS is the biggest NGO, foreign funded organization. Foreign funds are coming to RSS, not to any other organization. So such an organization, RSS, is only BJP, is only political tool. So through that BJP, RSS got power in end of 90s. But at that time, the situation was not right. Still, other parties were there. Congress was not decimated. Congress was not totally destroyed. Opposition parties were there. So BJP ruled for, Vajpayee ruled for a term. During that period, we must know what they did. In India, the most neoliberal, most reactionary policies were brought by BJP. For example, GST. GST started by Vajpayee. Second generation of globalization started by Vajpayee. So when Vajpayee came to power, within a few years, he initiated what is called the second generation of globalization in India. Manmohan Singh started, Congress started in 91, but BJP initiated the second stage and the GST was implemented. What is the importance of GST? You ask Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Stalin, the power of the state to tax, the power of the state to mobilize revenue is taken away by center. The state governments have no power now. No money with the state government. All tax powers were taken away by the center. Who is ruling the center? RSS, BJP. So now power is with them. The federal structure of the constitution is destroyed. So these policies were initiated by RSS, BJP. Leave it. Now, in the meanwhile, as a result of this intensification of policies, what is the advantage of RSS? RSS has an advantage. What is advantage? They are always with imperialism. They are always with colonialism during the colonial period and in the post-war neo-colonial period. That means we are in a neo-colonial period. That means today, we are ruled by imperialism still, but not direct. We are ruled by IMF. We are being ruled by World Bank. We are ruled by MNCs. Our policies are initiated by those who are returned from IMF. Prime Minister Modi, advising Modi, all those IMF pensioners and World Bank pensioners are advising him. It is not our IAS officers, it is not our IPS officers who are advising him. Modi is recruiting KPMG. You know KPMG, a global multinational consulting company. It is the mastermind of multinational tax avoidance. Multinational tax avoidance, how tax can be avoided? Such a international consulting companies, their officers are recruited by Modi to advise him. Modi is appointing officers from World Bank. Modi is appointing retired, those who are retired from IMF, not our officers. This is the situation. So policy decisions are made in corporate boardrooms, not in parliament, not in cabinet. Policy decisions are now made in corporate boardrooms. So junior partners, this Ambani is using the technology of digital technology of Facebook. Zuckerberg, we know this Jio mobile you use, this technology, the software of this Jio is provided by Facebook. It is provided by imperialism, multinational companies, Silicon Valley. The monopolies in Silicon Valley is providing. So American imperialism is controlling. World Bank is controlling. Not only Modi, even Kerala, Pinarayi, here in Tamil Nadu, everywhere they are controlling. No problem. So I am saying, so RSS is, after the Second World War, they are serving imperialism better than any other force. For example, I am giving you an example. Just one example. America was bombing. America was bombing Vietnam in the 70s. World people, all over the world, they were against America. America was isolated at the global level. America was isolated. All world people, all countries, even anti-communists. Anti-communists, those who are against communism, they were also with Vietnam. Many scholars, many eminent people, many intellectuals, they were supporting Vietnam and against America. You might have heard about Bertrand Russell. Bertrand Russell was not a communist, but Bertrand Russell was against America. He, in a telephone, in a radio speech, Bertrand Russell, he asked to American soldiers, you move from Vietnam, you should not interfere in Vietnam. Bertrand Russell, the Nobel Prize winner, asked the American soldiers in a radio speech. So that was the situation. At that time, when the world was against America, RSS leader Paul Volcker, he sent a letter to Johnson, then American president, Lyndon Johnson. Many people don't know all these things. These are from archives. Lyndon Johnson was the American president at that time. So this Paul Volcker was, he died in 73. When Lyndon Johnson was the president, Volcker sent a letter to Lyndon Johnson. That letter was given in the hands of Vajpayee. Vajpayee was the leader of the Janasangh, parliament, opposition leader at that day. So Vajpayee took this letter from Volcker. Volcker is the master, the old powerful leader of RSS. So Volcker called Vajpayee, who became the Indian Prime Minister. So Volcker gave this letter to whom? Vajpayee, to give it to Lyndon Johnson. Vajpayee gave this letter to Johnson in America. This letter came out. In that letter, this RSS chief, he praised America. America is the embodiment of Dharma. Dharma means justice. The world is engaged in a war between Dharma and Adharma. Justice and injustice. War between justice and injustice. In that war, America stands with the side of justice. That means Vietnam is injustice, America is justice. This is Volcker. So in that day, in the post-war period, these RSS was serving imperialism. Even now, they are serving imperialism. Therefore, in the neoliberal period, in India, a fascist state can be established with the help of RSS. RSS ideology. What is RSS ideology? Hindutva, Manusmriti. That is, they demanded The Indian court institution should be Manu Smriti. They have started it. How? They implemented Citizenship Amendment Act, denying Muslims citizenship. Muslims have no citizenship right. If you are Muslim, you have no citizenship. That is their policy. And if you are Kashmir, 370, Article 370, taken away. Why? Kashmir became a part of India after power transfer, based on this article, because Kashmir was not part of India at that time. Kashmir, then there was an undertaking, yes, there was a treaty. According to Article 370, Indian Parliament can make acts only in external affairs, in currency, and in one more thing, in defense of it. No other issue, Indian Parliament can pass act for Kashmir, because Kashmir was not part of India. Kashmir became part of India because of this condition. Narendra Modi amended, he took away that act. This is fascism. Citizenship Amendment Act, this is fascism. Muslims have no right. So in that way, Ram Temple, can a prime minister go in a secular country? He can put a foundation for Ram Temple? No, we are not a theocratic state. We are a democratic. That is the constitution says that the state is not based on religion, but they are converting India into a Hindu Rashtra. I am saying, comrades, so the problem is that this RSS is becoming the ideological basis of Marxism today. So what the RSS decides, that is the law. What the RSS demands, that is the law. There is the Modi government is an agent, is a tool of RSS to BJP. This is happening. And as part of this, extreme liberal, neoliberal policies, far right, ultra rightist economic policies, pro corporate policies. The state is becoming a facilitator of corporate capital. State has abandoned all its state-led development role. State has moved away from economy. Economy is our country, industry, agriculture, service. All sectors are given to corporates. State has moved away from economy and state has become a facilitator of corporate capital. That is what is Modi government. Planning commission. Planning commission is abandoned. It is over. Now decisions are taken in corporate boardrooms. Niti Aayog, I am not going into those details. So in order to implement these policies, in order to implement these far-right corporate policies, the ideological basis is needed. An ideological basis is needed. That ideological basis is Manu Smriti, which is the RSS ideology. And I am concluding with some more points. A few more points which are very important. One point, you know, I am concluding with some few points I am concluding. One is, in Meerut, a Manu court is started. Manu court means, in that court, Manu Smriti is followed. Under this government, here is a constitution, here is Supreme Court, here is courts. But in Meerut, a Manu court is working. Still working.
That is constitution.
Yeah?
That is constitution. Manu.
Manu has become, Manu Smriti has become the rule in India. Meerut court is now working. This is started. In that court, the rule is, the law is based on Manu Smriti. That court is run by RSS. Vishwahinduvari, this Agila Bharata Vidyarthi Parishad. I mean, Agila Bharata
VHP.
An organization.
VHP.
VHP. They are leading the Manu court. That is one. Now military. Gonsale school, only one military school. Now, RSS has started many military schools in India. Military schools are there. We have Indian Military Academy run by government. parallel to that, RSS has many military schools, PPP model, private, public-private partnership. We have roads in public-private partnership, public sector, private sector, PPP model. That means government money will be used by Ambani, Adani, they will construct road. Government will give them money, using that money they will construct road. And in the name of road they will get money from bank. State bank will give them money. DMK Chief Minister Stalin will not be given money from state bank. But Ambani, Adani calling state bank officer, born, the state bank will take money to his home. That is the bank here. So the banks will call, give money to Ambani Adani. They will get money in the name of PPP project, public-private partnership project. Government will give the money for construction. And after construction, the project will be held by them. And they will collect what is called, they will collect toll. This is the method. So I am not explaining much. So this type of things are going on. So in this process, what is going on? The RSS is being the ideological basis of these policies. So in the same manner, this PPP project in military means public-private. That means the private sector is RSS. RSS is cooperating with the Modi government. Now we have 35 military schools. Now another 100 military schools are going to be established. And these 100 military schools will be on PPP basis by RSS. Those who are coming out of these military schools, directly recruited as Indian Army officers. So RSS will become Indian military army officers directly. There is no, like Hitler and Mussolini, they have to work hard, they have to undermine, they have to eliminate the parliament, they have to eliminate the constitution. Today no need. RSS is slowly creeping into the system, establishing a fascist state, and by 1925, 100 years, they are moving towards a full-fledged Hindu Rashtra. So this is the problem that we are facing, and this is how we have to understand neo-fascism in India. So this is a very serious challenge before the people, and how we must fight this. With that, I will be concluding. We can explain any amount, we can go on this explanation because they are very complex. At the same time, very serious question, political, economic, social, cultural, intellectual, many dimensions are there. So we are not going into those details. What should be our task? What should be our task? That we have to decide. Just one point. Today, we know that how this fascist threat, neo-fascism means fascism today, how this neo-fascist threat can be challenged, how it can be resisted, who can do that? From the explanation that I have made, one thing is very clear. Many people can say fascism, fascism, but who can challenge fascism? Only those who are capable of making a correct political evaluation of what is it. Because if you have to treat a disease, the diagnosis should be correct. If you are not diagnosing, if your diagnosis is not correct, your treatment will not be correct. Treatment can be correct. Treatment is efficient only if your diagnosis is correct. Therefore, we should have a correct understanding of what is going on. In that perspective, only those revolutionary forces, communist forces, progressive forces, who are capable to analyze this situation, who are having an alternative political program, who are having an alternative political strategy, only they can lead the struggle. If not, what will happen? Suppose today many movements are there, anti-fascist movements. What will happen? Suppose BJP is now BJP is lost in a particular situation, either in the state or in the center. After some time, what will happen? Congress will come or some other ruling class parties will come. They have no difference with the BJP in terms of policies. Congress has no difference. The same policy. Congress also pursue the same policy. Only difference in degree. Only difference in degree. So if the Congress comes to power, within a few days, the BJP will again succeed because they have an organization. No other party has an organization like RSS. RSS has permitted. It has born into the roots of the country, 100 years. It has born into each and every aspect of the country. So RSS can manipulate any party. Mohan Bhagwat, the leader of the RSS, has said, we don't want BJP. We can use any party as our political tool. BJP is only one of our tools. We can use up Kejriwal. Now Kejriwal is the big team of RSS. It is exposed to them. Who supported the CIA and these fascist policies. Even other parties, they can be used by BJP, RSS, no problem for RSS. RSS has only one agenda, establishing a Hindu Rashtra. Therefore, those parties who are proponents of neoliberalism, who are proponents of corporatization, who are proponents of the far-right policies, they cannot lead the anti-fascist struggle. Even if they defeat BJP, RSS will again come to power. Therefore, the leadership of the anti-fascist struggle should be, only the leadership can be given to those forces who are capable to put forward a political alternative. That is very important. So ideological political clarity is very important. At the same time, they alone cannot do the task, because today we know what the communists did in the second, in the interwar period, led by the communists. Fascism was defeated by joining with even imperialist poets, because America, Britain, Soviet Union made an alliance with America and Britain to defeat Hitler and Mussolini. But Soviet Union has to lead it. At that time, Soviet Union was leading the socialist world. All over the world, the communist movement was advancing. Soviet Union was leading. So Soviet Union could lead the movement. Therefore, fascism was defeated. Today, such a movement should come. Only they can lead, and the other ruling class parties can be tactically joined, anti-fascist forces, because fascism is a special case. Fascism means the most reactionary terrorist section of the ruling class, that is RSS. We will not say that Congress is fascist. No, Congress is not fascist. We will not say. But Congress cannot defeat fascism, because Congress policies are neoliberal. Congress has no alternative. So therefore, the communists should come forward. The progressive forces should come forward. They, the struggling left forces, should take the initiative with an alternative, and led by them, anti-fascist forces can be united. Otherwise, what will happen? Fascists will again come to power. Therefore, I am concluding, our task is to build up, to develop at the top level and the bottom level. We have to build up mass political platforms. We have to build up struggling platforms of anti-fascist forces led by revolutionary left struggling forces. Otherwise, fascism cannot be defeated. Even if we see some temporary setback, fascists will again come to power. Therefore, the task is very serious and long time consuming. Not easy. It is not easy. You cannot defeat BJP by an election. You can defeat BJP in an election, but you cannot defeat RSS in an election. RSS will still remain. RSS is that much powerful. No other organization in the world is there that is so powerful that as RSS. That much power is there. It is not a simple thing. So the revolutionary forces, democratic forces, those who are with the people should think over this question very seriously, and they should come forward for a political alternative that is only task for defeating fascism, neo-fascism. Thank you, comrades.